Well, thank you to PJ for the kind introduction. It's my real pleasure to be here, and I'd like to start by thanking Allison Cuddy, Olivia Cunningham, and everyone with the Chicago Humanities Festival for the invitation. We're going to be talking today about the relationship of artistic production and landscape, specifically through the lens of speed. And I'm going to think about speed in terms of slowness and fastness. The primary topic of this lecture will be about art produced relatively recently, in the last 50 years, a movement called land art. But before we get to land art, I'd like to look back at the very beginning of this talk to the longer relationship of art and landscape, specifically through the genre of landscape painting. And I'd like to do so through some of the truly remarkable works that are in the collections here at the Art Institute of Chicago. So we see here a Poussin from roughly 1640 depicting St. John of Patmos in an allegorical landscape. And what's important about Poussin's work in the 1640s and 1650s is that he took the ambitions of history painting, the genre of painting that stood atop all the others in the kind of hierarchy of the day, and that was meant to convey the seriousness of biblical stories, of the classical literary tradition. Poussin took the ambitions of history painting and embedded them into landscape, where landscape becomes the vehicle for thinking about longer trajectories of time, for thinking about, in the case of St. John of Patmos, who's pictured here writing the Book of Revelation, about apocalyptic time even. So this is to say that Poussin wasn't, he didn't ignore the landscape outside his front door. I mean, he paints this way as a French artist who had moved to Rome because he, in fact, is sketching in the Italian landscape. But no aspect of Poussin's landscape is something that you could actually find outdoors. The goal of this version of landscape painting was to create an ideal relationship between natural forms and our ability to perceive them, the way that the space within this picture gradually recedes through no sharp contrast, the way that everything is carefully balanced and idealized. This is the classical vision of landscape. Jumping forward 200 years to J.M.W. Turner in England, a painting in the center that we have here in Chicago and on the left and right in London at the National Gallery and Tate, respectively. Turner takes this tradition of landscape painting and turns from the studio back out into the world. These are not pictures that are produced at the scene that they're depicting, but they nonetheless register the radical changes that were happening to the landscape of England during the rise of the Industrial Revolution. We see in Turner's depiction of a train on the left, the merging of the atmosphere with the train moving through it, and also the exhaust or steam coming out of the engine on the front of that train. This is likewise in the coal smoke pictured above the Thames on the right. And in the picture in the center, which combines the force of a snowstorm, a thunderstorm, and an avalanche all into one that's shipwrecked the group of people we see at the bottom right, there's nothing industrial or explicitly technological happening in the scene, but what this picture registers is not the absence of those forces, but the way that they had changed Turner's mode of engaging with and perceiving the landscape. The kind of cloud forms that take over the center of Turner's paintings have everything to do with the era of smog, the combination of the natural and the industrially produced or the technological. Taking one last snapshot at this history of landscape painting, we have Monet painting haystacks in the early 1890s. As I'm sure you're familiar with, this is not the only one of these haystacks. Monet painted dozens and dozens of this scene, sometimes as a single haystack, sometimes as a pair that we see here, where the importance of this series was about the specificity of the way that light was hitting the haystack at just a particular way at the moment that we see depicted. And what's important to keep in mind is that Monet didn't paint this all at once out in a field in France. That in fact, he began the work there and then he took it back to his studio and he took them back and forth and back and forth, waiting for these light effects to appear once again so he could work on this particular canvas. So Monet in fact paints this picture over a relatively long period of time, but paints it in such a way to make it look instantaneous. On the exact opposite end of the spectrum from Poussin thinking about the landscape as a vehicle for the classical tradition, for thinking about the landscape as existing within this very long stretch of history, Monet's landscape is an instantaneous experience. Although the picture itself is not produced instantaneously, what it does is it puts an emphasis on the moment, and this we can see in the brushwork of Monet's finish, this kind of impasto that particularly builds up on the edges where sunlight is striking, the kind of sloped edge of these haystacks, that this is meant to impart the kind of activity, the kind of immediacy through which the artist put this moment down on the canvas. So what we have over the stretch is an increasing turn away from the kind of idealization of landscape and into the direct experience of the landscape of our own time. This moves us forward to the main subject of this lecture, which is the rise of land art in the 1960s. This happens simultaneously in Western Europe and the United States, although the majority of this work, and maybe the best known, most iconic examples of this work, exist in the American West. What you see on the left is a work by the British sculptor Richard Long, in which to make a work of sculpture, he took a bucket of plaster and he poured it onto the lawn in Bristol, England. And the shape that the sculpture took was directed by the shape of the land itself, such that even, you know, what we see here is a picture of this work, but the experience of it had to take place or has to take place at the place it was made. You'd have to pick up the entire landscape itself if you wanted to move this sculpture. What we see on the right is a piece by Michael Heiser called North. It consists of two cubes that he set into the ground, one below the next, in the Sierra Nevada Mountains in California. The work has since been taken back up into the land, and this is a topic that I'll return to later. For now, I'd like to register a few things about this land work. The first is its remoteness. We have a photograph of it, but we have very few accounts of people who had actually seen it. Heiser made this in a way almost for himself or for the camera, which is another important idea. The other aspect about this work is that Heiser is taking sculptural forms and embedding them into the landscape, that he's working with the land directly, as opposed to in that landscape tradition, depicting it. This is not a representational work of the land. This is a work that directly employs the qualities of the environment itself. But he's taking a kind of arbitrary sculptural form, a cube, and planting it into that landscape. So this is something I want to continue thinking a little bit further about as we look to two of the most iconic works of land art. On the left, another piece by Michael Heiser called Double Negative, completed in 1969, and on the right, Robert Smithson's Spiral Jetty, which is a work in the Great Salt Lake in Utah, then therefore experiences fluctuating levels of water. This is a photograph I took when I was there when it was half submerged. First, Double Negative. Double Negative, as the name suggests, consists of negative form rather than positive form. It was created on a mesa in Nevada, just outside a little town called Overton. And what Heiser did is he excavated two cuts in this landscape. And as we can see from a detail of one of these sides, the cuts are very precise. They're a little, in fact quite a lot, like the minimalist sculpture you see here, which preceded this work in the 1960s, driven by two aspects that I'd like to emphasize, one being the hard geometrical form of this sculpture, mostly consisting of cubes with an emphasis on repetition. Minimalism is famous for its boxes. The other aspect of this work that I'd like to pick up on is that of scale. And recall that scale is a different issue from that of size. Sizes are absolute, whereas scales exist in relation, one size in relation to another size. The scale of minimalism, quite famously and controversially in its own day, was roughly that of human size. Minimalist sculptures are not small enough that you can imagine picking them up, and they're not big enough that you encounter them like monuments. Instead, you encounter them as something like the scale of another person, so that when you see them in a gallery, it's like encountering another being. This idea of scale and also of the geometric form of minimalism proved important to Heiser's conception of how to engage directly with landscapes in the production of his land art. This is because what he produces with Double Negative is a kind of minimalist sculpture embedded within the land. And this doesn't just have to do with the kind of rigidness of the walls that he carved into this mesa, but what actually happens when you walk into the work. So imagine what this sculpture looks like. It exists on a mesa, which is a very flat form on the top that rises sharply from the landscape. And it has this ramp that you walk down. And when you enter this work, which is 50 feet in height, 30 feet across, and roughly 15 feet long on both sides, it looks like just a cut until you get inside of it. And then you realize that you have a kind of mirror relationship with the other cut, which is precisely calibrated one to the other. And what forms is your experience of, in fact, a double negative. The two negatives become a positive in the sense that you feel yourself taken up or embodied within a giant, invisible, minimalist sculpture in the landscape that is trapezoidal in its shape, that it's flat across the top, it curves on the sides, and is flat again across the bottom. As if he'd taken this giant form and embedded within the landscape, but yet it's invisible, and it only exists because of your perception and engagement with the work. Now, this also has an important aspect to do with scale, because this is a photograph I took with my back to double negative. This shows you what the landscape of the mesa itself looks like. There's, in fact, a little municipal airport just to the left center of the picture, but you wouldn't know that looking at the landscape itself, because it's so utterly flat, and the hills in the distance are so utterly distant that you basically have no way of engaging with or relating to this landscape when you're standing there. You are an alien figure in the scale of the desert. Stepping into double negative, and I should note this is what it looks like now, which is something else that we'll return to. Stepping into double negative, the work is large, but in fact it's also small enough that we as a spectator are able to relate to it. It's roughly the size of a small piece of architecture. It's house-like or home-like. It has a scale that's small enough that we can relate to it. It's also important that double negative isn't just a hole in the ground, that it's actually open on one end. This is because when you're taken into double negative because of its smallness, you also begin to realize that the work is additionally large enough that it can relate to other things in the landscape, that one side of the cut relates to the other side of the cut, that those cuts, because of this kind of invisible minimalist form that you are standing within when you're inside the piece, is large enough to be able to relate to other scallops on the edge of the mesa in which it exists. And those scallops can relate to other mesas in the environment, to the river valley in between them, and suddenly, the alienation that we, as a visitor to the work, feel standing on this mesa is obliterated as we actually enter into the scale of the landscape itself. So Heiser takes this minimalist idea that a work of art is meant to create a scalar relationship between object and subject and uses it as a medium for thinking about how we might, as we as subjects, might relate to a larger landscape. So we actually enter into a scalar relation of the landscape only through Heiser's sculpture within it. Another piece that I'd like to talk briefly about in framing these general issues about land art is Robert Smithson's Spiral Jetty. And I'd like to say just this about it for now, which is that part of what makes double negative unusual within the history of art, part of what makes a good deal of land art unusual within the history of art, is that if you want to experience the work, you have to drive up a mesa in Nevada, precariously navigate the edge of it until you find Heiser's work, and then walk into the sculpture. Photographs exist that I can show you all in lecture halls such as this, but they don't substitute for what actually happens at the work. Unlike a painting or a sculpture that another museum might take on loan from an institution across the world, these works don't move. They are specific in their orientation to the place in which they are made. It's a unique relationship to the landscape. However, some of these artists, most notably Robert Smithson, realized that inevitably photographs would be taken of these works and that that many audiences would engage with his land art primarily through the photography, or at least in different ways with respect to both photography that you might look at sitting in your loft studio in New York City and the work itself, which you have to see in this case in the Great Salt Lake in Utah. So what Smithson did is he theorized the relationship between the site of the work in Utah and what he called the non-sites, and we might just more generally call photography and film, of these pieces that circulate. So what you see on the right here are stills from a film that Smithson made of Spiral Jetty. That's not strictly documentary in its nature, but rather sets up a relationship where part of the work is filmic, part of this work is photographic, and part of this work is site-specific, meaning it exists as a spiral of rocks and dirt in the Great Salt Lake. Now, with respect to speed, this notion of being there, of being at the site and experiencing the work through the kind of direct encounter with a landscape, sets up a quite different relationship to our encounter with landscapes in these photographs that circulate about earthworks. And this is something that another one of these artists, whose name is Walter de Maria, began to problematize in the year 1969. You see two works by de Maria pictured on the screen here. On the left, a piece called Desert Cross, which he made in the spring of that year, which consists of two very long chalk lines that he drew onto the floor of the Mojave Desert and then photographed from the air. Now, walking along these chalk lines doesn't give you, or wouldn't at the time have given you, a sense of the overall work. You would have to construct it in your mind. And yet, the most iconic pictures of this sculpture are not from the ground, but rather from the air, where we can see precisely what it is, that it's a cross and that it's at a very large size. That little dot that you see to the left side of the intersection is a person standing beside the work. So this began to trouble de Maria because it meant that for the majority of people thinking about his work as they encountered it through the photographs, it seemed like the main aspect of this work was the cross, was a kind of instantaneous symbol or form that you could perceive from the photograph. And what gets lost in that version of the work is the importance of actually exploring those lines and trying to figure out what exactly you're looking at. And of course, the fact that the chalk lines drawn on a dry desert floor don't last very long. They'll blow away in a matter of days. That there will be a legible version of the sculpture for a period of time, but it won't ever look quite like what we see in the photograph. The photograph holds on to it a little too tightly. It's a little too constrictive. So in response to this, de Maria's very next major work of land art, which he titled Las Vegas Piece, which we see on the right, for this work, he stipulated that there would be no aerial photographs, which makes it a little difficult to talk about in lecture halls, actually, because we have very little photographic evidence of the work. This is one shot taken early on, and what the work consisted of was also a pattern that he drew onto the floor of the desert, in this case in the Tula Desert in Nevada. But for Las Vegas Piece, rather than a recognizable symbol like a cross, he instead drew two intersecting lines that had two smaller intersecting lines in the middle. The best way I have to describe is that it looks like the chalk lines of a baseball field without the outfield barrier. It looks like the foul lines with the sort of lines drawn for the base pass in the middle. Now, importantly, part of the reason that this is a Las Vegas piece rather than desert piece or some other title is that de Maria realized that to get to the work, you would probably start in the nearest major city, which is Las Vegas. And you would have to drive 60-odd miles on the highway and then 30-odd miles by dirt road to try and find the thing. Here's me trying to find it unsuccessfully a couple summers ago. This is the only earthwork I've looked for and never found. Twice I've tried. Twice I failed. So de Maria conceptualized the work as also encapsulating the journey to it, that it would take you several hours to reach the work and that you would have to drive highways and then dirt roads. And then you'd have to, when you got to the work, you might have heard a description of what the form of it looked like, but you'd actually have to walk the thing to perceive it. And because it was consisted of such shallow cuts into the desert floor, in fact, part of the idea of the work was that you had to be inside of it to perceive, in fact, where it went. That you wouldn't be able to see it from as close as a few dozen feet away. Now, part of the difficulty of this work, of course, is that it has been taken back up into the ground. Some claim. Others claim that because the plant growth hasn't returned to that area of the desert, that Las Vegas Piece still exists. Between these points, we could agree that at least Las Vegas Piece has a kind of ambiguous relationship to perception. And I would contend that, in fact, not finding it produced a new appreciation of the work I don't think I would have gathered otherwise, which is that what you're trying to find is a shape cut somewhat arbitrarily into an otherwise expansive and evenly distributed desert floor. And that's precisely what you realize driving on your way out to find it, that our experience of landscape is so often shaped by the arbitrary placing of lines, which in this case involves not only highways and then dirt roads and what you might walk when you get to the work, but also the fence lines, the electrical wires, the phone lines, the railways that have defined the shaping of the Western United States in particular. So Las Vegas peace then not only asks for a certain kind of duration that you spend most of a day driving to the work, walking the work, and then returning to the city, but that you also experience different paces, different speeds of experiencing landscape on the way there, highway, dirt road, and then finally on foot in the desert. Now, of course, these aspects of Las Vegas peace are mostly implicit. De Maria assumed this is how one might engage with his work, but it wasn't actually internalized into the work itself. That would happen with his next major piece, which he did in New Mexico and finished in the year 1977. This work is called The Lightning Field, of which we see a photograph here. It consists of 400 stainless steel poles planted within a site in the shape of a large rectangle, 1 mile in length and 1 kilometer in width. The poles are 220 feet apart. Now, visiting the lightning field is a, well, we'll say that the lightning field has a rather unusual visitation policy, which is that you can't just show up at the work. You have to book your reservation in advance, and you have to be dropped off at the work by the Dia Art Foundation, which owns and maintains the site. Only 6 people at a time can visit the work, and those people have to stay for a full day. You get dropped off in the early afternoon, you get picked up in the late morning. Part of the reason for this is that what you are to experience at the lightning field is a kind of lived duration of the work's relationship to the landscape. That kind of implicit length of time that was in Las Vegas piece is now made more formal in the fact that the artist prescribes, and some people think a little too restrictively, that you have to spend a full day at the lightning field. Now, what you realize in being there, and this comes to a great surprise of many people who visit the lightning field, and I would include myself in that group, is that what we learn of Walter de Maria's land work before we get to the site in New Mexico mainly has to do with lightning. The name of the work is The Lightning Field. It has a series of iconic photographs that have been published about it. Maybe most famously, this cover of Art Form magazine in April of 1980. And in fact, the work is sited at an area with a high frequency of lightning during the so-called high season of August and September. There might be 2 to 3 strikes a month, which is a high frequency of lightning for any given site. But yet, the chances of any given person actually seeing the field get hit by lightning when you visit is rare. And so what actually happens is that you, because you don't get this kind of instantaneous thrill that the photography suggests that the work is about, you instead perceive a much slower and distributed version of the lightning field. Here's a close-up of one of the poles. And when you arrive at midday to this site, your experience of the work has mostly to do with being close to these objects, that each one becomes a kind of individualistic or singular sculpture. Because the way that light strikes the top of these poles, and I should mention that they're also pointed at the top, which affects the way that they appear. You can see poles that might be 20, 30 yards from you, but those in the distance fade, kind of shimmer like a highway does in bright sunlight, which makes it look like you're in an infinitely expansive field and that you're in kind of encountering one thing after the next. You can't think of the lightning field as a whole singular thing. And yet, as the day progresses and the light shifts its angle from the sun, the whole field snaps into view in the evening. As sun no longer strikes the top of those pointed poles, but strikes the side, the poles begin to take on different colors of the sunset, yellows, oranges, reds, and you begin to think of the field in different ways. This, of course, wouldn't be possible to experience directly unless you were there for a number of hours. Now, of course, we do have to deal with the fact that, these photographs still exist of the lightning field, and the artist clearly chose to publish photographs that emphasize lightning on top of or over and above these other aspects of the work that I've been describing. So one way that we might come to terms about this is to think about the lightning field as actually setting into relationship these two aspects of land art with respect to speed that I've been describing. That this work both engages photographic or reproducible media for its quickness, for its instantaneity, for the all-at-onceness through which you can experience a landscape. A version of Monet written into a different media, we might say. The other way to experience this landscape, of course, is through slowness and a kind of lived embodiment. And so if Robert Smithson's spiral jetty split the work into different media, photographs, film, sight, where each one nonetheless constitute a similar work, de Maria's move was to break his work into different media, photographs, and sight, where each of those media presented a different way to experience the speed of the landscape. Now, in invoking Monet a moment ago, I want to call our attention back to the beginning of this lecture, where we initially began thinking about the role of industrialization on the land. Because, in fact, the relationship of land art to the speed at which we experience landscape isn't entirely embodied within the original work itself. All works of art, for the most part, have lives beyond their initial viewing. Paintings, whether they are currently on a wall or in storage, are meant to last for a long period of time. These works were also meant to last for a long period of time, but they don't sit within the climate control walls of a museum. They sit out in the land itself. And so in the case of Michael Heiser's Double Negative, as was intimated earlier in one of the photographs I showed you, the work had to do with industrial production at its, you know, in its original version. This work isn't simply a kind of negative carving out of the land. This took bulldozers, that this was a major operation. Something that Heiser alludes to in these photographs that were published in a famous catalog on information by the Museum of Modern Art in 1970, where we see the plumes of dust kicked up by the explosions he used to carve out the sculpture. Explosions that also clearly call to mind the other violent activity in the Nevada desert in the 20th century of nuclear testing. But note that Heiser doesn't even label them. This doesn't say Double Negative under construction. These are just clouds of dust in the desert. Of course, from that initial industrial activity of Heiser working in the desert, the work inevitably always was going to change over time, that it wasn't going to maintain those clean, minimalist lines. And so one sense in which land art exists within a changing landscape has to do with its relationship to this kind of production, this kind of shaping of the land that's become ever more dramatic and existing at larger scales within the era of industrialism. And on the other hand, because of the changing nature of environments themselves, that one of the great insights of ecology of the 20th century is that there is no steady state to any environment, that environments are always changing, but they're changing at different speeds depending on whether they're actively being addressed or influenced or affected by, say, human activity, or whether those changes are happening on a longer scale, kind of longer cycles of change. So this is one thing that's registered in Double Negative, in the fact that when you go to see it today, it looks more like what you see on the left than, sorry, what you see on the right than what you see on the left. A final aspect of land art's changing relationship to speed that I'd like to bring out has to do with climate change. And we can think about this through Robert Smithson's Spiral Jetty. Spiral Jetty, like Double Negative, was a work that had been created from the beginning with a sense of its own cyclical change at the site. That quite famously, once Spiral Jetty opened in 1970 and iconic pictures such as this one were taken of it, it disappeared for about 30 years. The level of the lake rose to its historically normative levels, and Spiral Jetty was covered with water. It still existed, you just couldn't see it if you visited the site. Since it has reappeared, the relationship of the work to water levels in the lake has taken on a different kind of relationship, which is to say that if you visit it today, likely what you'll see is a far more desiccated work with the water level of the lake far away from the piece, the kind of relationship of the pinkness of the water to the blueness of the surround that Smithson had thought very carefully about that's produced because of algae that live in the salt lake and is affected by the level of salinity, which, you know, increases within the spiral form of the work. That this, in a sense, is no longer part of the work that we experience at the Great Salt Lake. Because rather than a historically normative rising and falling of the waters of the Great Salt Lake, climate change has affected the dryness of this lake to such an extent that Spiral Jetty, for the most part now, exists like this. which is to say that this is an element of Smithson's work that, unlike, say, the erosion nut double negative or the partially covered and partially uncovered relationship of spiral jetty, was not conceptualized by the artist at the time of this work's making. This is something that's come about because of the fact that works of land art live in the land themselves, in the land itself. That they both serve as indexes for not only ways of experiencing landscape through a kind of quickness and slowness on a day-to-day level, they not only speak to our habitual ways of understanding landscape, but they also provide a more generational frame for thinking about the scale and the speed at which we experience landscapes. One of the great challenges of ecological thought, ecological thinking, as it relates especially to how we ethically sustain the Earth, is that it's very difficult to see climate change. It's very difficult to see ecological processes that happen at large scales. And so perhaps inadvertently, based on the initial conception of land art, one of the things that it's now serving to do is provide just this kind of index for thinking about larger and slower, but no less impactful scales of time in the landscape. Thank you.
At this time, we'd like to open up the floor for questions. If you have a question, just raise your hand. We're going to come to you with a microphone. We're taping the event, so we want to make sure
I'm
we
really
get this
loud.
On the mic.
What relationship to historic land art might you expound upon, like the mound builders or the Incas with their land art?
Mm-hmm. Great question. There's varying degrees to which these artists thought about more historical earthworks, both indigenous or otherwise. Robert Smithson had a lot of things to say about geological eras, about dinosaurs. He didn't have much to say about indigenous landforms. Michael Heiser, on the other hand, his father was an archaeologist. And in fact, Heiser's relationship to the West was formed when he was a kid by going out on digs with his father. So there was actually a quite direct relationship in Heiser's work to these larger earth forms. So it really, I guess the short answer would be it varies artist to artist across the group. Yeah.
On the practical side, these artists spend many months and years creating these works of art with limited access to the public. How does one make a living from this?
It's a great question. And it actually proved a major problem in the lifespan of this work. I mean, chronologically, the last thing I showed you was the lightning field, which De Maria completed in 77. It actually took him 5 or 6 years to make it just because he didn't have the money. The period in which these works existed is really the last couple years of the 60s and the first couple years of the 70s. And the reason has a lot to do with their impracticality in terms of cost and a relationship to the viewing public. What allowed for a good deal of this work was that these artists, for the most part, showed their sculpture, their sort of smaller scale work, at the same gallery in New York called the Dwan Gallery. And Virginia Dwan facilitated their work out west, knowing that it wouldn't be saleable in the same kind of way that a work of sculpture was saleable. But it ended up bankrupting the gallery. And so when this happened, Robert Smithson, for instance, completely recast himself as a consultant for land reclamation. And Smithson dies at a tragic young age. His plane crashed in Amarillo while he was photographing a work that he was producing there. But for the last couple years of his life, he actively tried to seek funding from the private sector to produce these works, not very successfully. And what ended up happening, in fact, is that this as a genre of work was very short-lived, and the work that came out of it was much more civically oriented. So it would be in cities, or it was thinking about ecological reclamation at much more practical, say, or large scales. Or were artists that were making ecological works of art that could be shown in a museum. So that's the response that shows up in the 70s and largely characterizes the kind of environmental work that is done today.
Do you consider the, over here on the...
Yeah.
Do you consider the temporary interventions of an artist like Christo to be a part of this tradition, or is that something separate? And kind of in that same vein, the project that James Terrell has been working on for a long time in Arizona, is that totally different, or do you consider it kind of a part of this movement?
I personally consider it adjacent to the movement. So to maybe start with the second part of your question, the reference is to Roden Crater, which is a naked eye observatory that the artist James Terrell has been working on for decades in Arizona, and supposedly is close to opening to the public, but we'll see. It is a work that exists within this tradition of land art, but it also has its roots. Terrell is more or less of the same generation of these artists, but he starts out by controlling light within urban spaces and within rooms, and then begins to expand that to an environmental level, rather than working, say, the other way around. So Terrell and a number of artists, Michael Heiser, for instance, who's been working on an equally large complex he calls City in Nevada for several decades as well, have taken the kind of scalar relationships and the kind of economic investment in this work to an entirely new level. And since those works haven't opened to the public, we'll just have to wait and see how that works out. With respect to Christo is also of this generation, also interested in our experience of landscape, but in a way that's different enough that I would place him adjacent to this work, in the sense that Christo's pieces are always temporary. They're funded by the artist himself, and they tend to work from relationships of framing rather than, say, integration. That Christo will drape something, that he'll color something, rather than place his work into it. And so I think Christo's coming out of similar questions, but I think he's producing really quite different responses. Yes.
Hi. Could you please talk about the relationship of the contemporary artist Andrew Goldsworthy to this work?
Yes. Andy Goldsworthy is a little bit younger, but he's coming out of a British tradition of land art. I showed Richard Long at the very beginning that plaster runway down a lawn in Bristol, which one could argue is even the first work of land art from the 1960s. Goldsworthy is coming out of that British tradition, which is taking shape at around the same time, but out of more local conditions. So, for instance, the British artists are not thinking as much about minimalism. It's not they're not aware of minimalism, they're just not thinking about it as much as they might be thinking about local relationships to the land in England, sort of fair use, the agricultural history of England, the way in which the English landscape doesn't have the same kind of seemingly open or unmarked desert spaces that characterize the American West. So though Goldsworthy has come to stand in, I think, as maybe one of the most celebrated, one of the most noteworthy artists of this generation, I wouldn't disagree with that. I think of Goldsworthy as coming from a different track in terms of a historical relationship to the land than this particular American group.
Hey, I'm way up here.
Hi.
Thank you. I'm curious about how you understand or think about the relationship between visualizing these long, slow changes and action, and to the extent that being able to visualize something instigates or fails to instigate acting upon it, mm-hmm. Particularly with the challenge of visualizing the Anthropocene. And perhaps there are examples from older works, like with the Industrial Revolution. I don't know, I'm just curious how you're thinking about this.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think it's a fascinating question, thank you. I mean, I think part of the continuing importance of this work is embedded within actual landscapes for thinking about questions of, and the Anthropocene was mentioned for those unfamiliar, it's an idea that we might mark it at the beginning of the capitalist revolution in the Renaissance or the beginning of the Industrial Revolution in the 18th century, human production on the surface of the earth has accelerated to such an extent that we are now, as a collective whole, affecting the geological shape of the earth in such to such an extent that we could think of our own era as constituting a new geological era, the era of the humans, the Anthropocene. So I think part of what is important about land art in this respect is that it offers us very few singular images of the environment, that its work is more embedded into these changes and forces us to think about them in durational ways, or perhaps without a single picture onto which we could attach our understanding of a particular issue, say. In relation to this, one of the things that I'm particularly interested in is the role of abstract art or abstraction in the arts for thinking about these kinds of questions. Because when we think about impactful environmental art, it tends to be something like a photograph of a despoiled landscape. It tends to be something like a bird covered in oil. And while those photographs can have very beneficial and immediately impactful political effects for a given oil spill, for a given reclamation project, they tend to be more limiting in our way to think holistically about the interrelationship of a particular, say, environmental disaster and the ever-telescoping, you know, sequence of such disasters in combination with the ever-violent sequence of quote-unquote natural disasters that characterize this late industrial era that we live in. So I think not only land art, but also ways of non-picturing, or ways of being forced to imagine our relationship to landscape and to the earth in more durational ways, is really fundamental for advocating and promoting this more holistic view.
Hi, thank you very much. I was wondering if there's anyone under 40 or contemporarily doing this land art work.
Mm-hmm. That's a good question. There are artists who are making site-specific sculptures now, but they don't tend to be at these large scales, and they don't tend to be as remote, which is also to say artists now, it was possible in the year 1969 to imagine that what one was doing on a mesa in Nevada was simply making a sculpture and to not worry about the carbon footprint of that sculpture. That's simply not possible anymore. And so the kind of work that artists are doing that's site-specific, I might state an example. There's a series of photographs by an artist named Amy Balkin of parks, smog parks for cities, that are photographs that depict geometrical forms above a city that have to do with the relative pollution of that city, which is a way of picturing and a way of drawing upon the history of, say, geometrical form, minimalism, and site specificity without actually negatively impacting that landscape.
Thank you very much. I've had the good fortune of seeing a couple of these places you've mentioned, Spiral Jetty and the Lightning Field. Mm-hmm. And in your talk, I started thinking about another place I visited, Marfa, Texas.
Yes.
Where there's a lot of Donald Judd, for those that don't know, and other people, Carl Andre. And also, I was thinking about Storm King, where I've also visited, which has a combination of land art as well as big sculptures that are out in this immense field. So there's this continuum, and I don't know where the lines are between land art and sculpture gardens.
Yeah, quite frankly, a lot of people, I think, don't know quite where the lines are between land art and sculpture gardens. These artists themselves were quite resistant to the idea that their work would either be placed in a sculpture garden or would constitute a kind of sculpture garden. In, say, the desert, for example. But I think it's a much more nuanced relationship than that. Some of Smithson's late work he produced for a sculpture garden show in the Netherlands, for instance, but only because he deemed that he was reclaiming a post-industrial site. Some of the alternate works that I didn't show you today that tried to bridge minimalist sculpture with environmental or ecological thinking. In fact, did so in a way that was precisely for the sculpture park. So there's an artist named Peter Hutchinson, for instance, who, instead of taking minimalist form and embedding it directly into the landscape, he conceived of taking minimalist vessels and building ecosystems in a kind of terrarium model inside of the sculpture itself, and then placing them both in sculpture gardens and also in what he deemed to be extreme environments, such as icebergs and at the tip of volcanoes. Models for these works exist, scale models, but as an issue of funding gets in the way of a lot of this work, never was able to realize one actually at scale in a park.
You may have answered this question. As I was looking at these works of art, it occurred to me that it might be damaging the environment to actually create these works. And I wondered if it can be done now or whether it's really proper to do it.
Yeah, I mean, the short answer is yes. None of these works that I showed you today does anything except damage or disrupt its environment. Some do this less than others, say maybe the least impactful being the chalk drawing by De Maria in the desert. But he's nonetheless introducing a material to that environment that was not there to begin with. I was at another university a couple days ago with a group of students who had recently taken a tour of the earthworks in the American West. And the person leading that tour, in fact, had produced a work of dry ice as a carbon footprint, as a kind of visualization for thinking about what it even takes to go see these works, let alone to make these works. Because while the argument stands that to experience, say, double negative as it demands to be experienced in the way it was conceived, you need to go to the town of Overton outside of Las Vegas, and you need to drive up. There's only one way to get there unless you have a helicopter. You drive up on the top of this mesa, and then you go find the work. That means that the continuing presence of these works for audiences also has a significant carbon footprint, and that the more popular that works, say, like Spiral Jetty, become, the more miles they get logged going to and fro Roselle Point and the Great Salt Lake.
That was such an interesting talk, and I wanted to know if you could give us your observations about, obviously these are artists who are drawn to the West, it's a perfect environment for this kind of expression, and that has been also a site for artists throughout the history of American art.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I think about both painting and a kind of a Bierstadt, but also claiming areas of the West through photography like Carlton Watkins and others.
Mm-hmm.
And could you talk about some of the different impetus that you see as distinctions?
Sure. Yeah, that's a great question. I think while some of these artists imagine that they were forging a radical break with the conventions of engaging with the West by both landscape photographers and landscape painters, a case of this would be this piece, which is a combination of a photograph published also in a magazine by Walter De Maria. What you see is the advertisement for the work on the right that was actually exhibited at the time. And, you know, on the left, we see him laying down on the desert in one of these chalk drawings that he had made earlier that year. This is 1968 in California. And on the right is a sculpture that he calls Beds of Spikes, which consists of spikes that will, in fact, impale you if you were to lay down on them. This is the earliest version of the lightning field, by the way, is the sculpture. But the relationship with these, which seems to be non-existent in part, is that De Maria is forcefully stating his rejection of the city, the studio, as the site for the production of art. That he has this sort of anarchist sculpture, almost, that he's showing in a gallery, the advertisement for which says, if you really want to experience art, go west. And in fact, this would be the last piece of freestanding sculpture he showed for nearly a decade. That attitude, though, is not uniform across the entire group of artists. That someone I didn't talk about today named Dennis Oppenheim, one of the very first pieces that he produced was thematized around Mount Cotopaxi, which is one of the primary works in the landscape tradition of American painting. And so in Oppenheim's case, he was quite explicitly trying to link the direct work in the land that he was producing with the traditions of depicting the land and landscape. So rather than thinking about the formation of land art as splitting from that of representation is, in fact, conceiving of land art more as a continuation or reformulation of that tradition.
Thank you, that was very interesting. I was just wondering, all the artists that we've spoken about so far have been male, and I was just wondering if there have been, I was trying to rack my brain and go back over the survey classes I've taken of art history, and I couldn't even think of a woman artist who is in that kind of land art. And of course, Christo is married, but he is more known than, mm-hmm. But if there's any women land artists.
Yes, there are. This first generation, which begins in the late 60s, is pretty much a boys' club. The most iconic earthwork from the end of this first wave is by Nancy Holt. That's also in Utah. It's in northern Utah. It's called the Sun Tunnels. It consists of four very large cement culverts placed in a cross form in the desert that are cut on the top according to celestial patterns, and the works are cued to the solstices of the sun. And so the work is about experiencing the desert sculpturally. It's also about the relationship of being grounded on earth to looking up in the sky. So it's a kind of materiality, immateriality that's built into the work. Nancy Holt was Robert Smithson's partner and produced that work after Smithson had died, and also during his lifetime collaboratively made videos with him and films, in addition to making her own sculpture and photography. So the most prominent woman artist of the first wave of land art would be Nancy Holt. But part of the response to some of the problematic aspects of these practices, I pointed to the ethics of their incursions into the land earlier. I've pointed to the kind of remoteness or exclusivity of the work. Part of the response to that was also about the gendering of the work, the way it wasn't just made by men, but treated the land in this kind of historically masculine way, as if the desert was this kind of empty space awaiting inscription, awaiting kind of conquering by the artist. So the 1970s was also a decade in which a whole host of more explicitly feminist environmental practices arose in direct response to those qualities of this wave of work.
One more question. She's going to come to you over there.
Hi. Just a response to the earlier question about environmental impact of the land art. Considering what's going on with climate change and the way that things are changing, wouldn't an artist have an opportunity to create new environmental art like this to show, like you showed with Spiral Jetty, the changing of the climate, the changing of the land, and how we're impacting that, and that's an opportunity for artist commentary?
In general, yes. The response by many artists, however, has produced a kind of conflicting, or at least not kind of unified, sense of how to best address this, though. So there is a good deal of work today that is made collaboratively between, say, artists and scientific laboratories, between artists and environmental agencies, that is entirely about using the visual arts as a way to help people better understand and internalize the conditions that scientists are wanting to get across, how dire things are, what we need to do, where do we stand right now. Think of Al Gore riding that little conveyor at the end of his film. There is another wing of artistic production, however, which feels that that is in fact not the role of art. That art is best serving its audience when it's in fact not offering a direct message, or at least when it's offering multiple viewpoints, when it's offering something that you have to work through rather than the kind of impactfulness, say, of that lightning field photograph. That there's always this kind of counterpart, the relationship of the site to the photograph, rather than the work that aligns itself too closely with, say, the communications wing of be it an environmental agency, et cetera. And so this is, there's certainly differing opinions about this, and it's one of the things that is currently still being worked out in the relationship of art and the land. So thank you all.